Hi, I'm Kumi Taguchi. On this episode of Insight, trigger warnings. They're everywhere these days. They tell us what to avoid and what we might find upsetting. But are they doing more harm than good?
A number of people from our audience have told us that they would like a trigger warning.
I have a needle phobia, so I was reading a book that had a really graphic blood test scene in it, and it caused me a lot of distress.
My life for the last 7 years has been what other people would find triggering.
Are trigger warnings effective?
No, they don't really do much of anything.
I feel like this is sending us backwards instead of sending us forwards.
I'm a little bit confused as to how the topic is a topic.
Chris, you were deployed to Iraq while serving in the Australian Army. What was life like when you came back?
Yeah, I guess for me, initially, life was really good. But I think after that 2 or 3 month period, that's when things started crashing down. Back then, I was using alcohol and stuff like that to get to sleep. And I think I just felt like if I party every night, things will be okay. So I was young and naive.
You were diagnosed with post-traumatic stress disorder, or PTSD, 4 years ago. How does that manifest in your day-to-day life?
I think as time has gone on, you know, panic attacks have been a big thing for me. Seeing emergency vehicles, the mind instantly goes in that fight mode. And, yeah, it's very hard to come out of that. And so the emergency vehicles has been what's a massive trigger for me.
Earlier this year, you were part of the reality TV series Alone.
So we've got that chopper flying over, and now I'm just getting mad PTSD triggers. I don't know why. I don't know if it's like someone's hurt or like... PTSD's a...
Can you take us through what's happening there?
A helicopter came over, and initially I thought it was some sort of photography, part of the show. So I thought I'd play the scene and get out there and put my axe on and stand on a nice little point and not look at the cameras. And then quickly the helicopter sort of passed over a little knoll there and started lowering down. And I think even though it wasn't a Westpac chopper or emergency chopper, I knew it was a civilian one. So I think my brain went into gear that someone's hurt. But even though I was looking at the chopper and I knew it didn't have a stretcher on it, you know, my brain was just shutting down.
When you get those moments of being triggered, are they always that intense?
They're always that intense, definitely, but they're not as common in an everyday life out there on that experience. I was very heightened at that time. I think if the chopper had flown over on day one, then it would have probably had no effect. Mm-hmm. But just due to where I was physically and mentally, it sort of was enough to tip me over the edge.
What other things trigger your PTSD?
I pretty much just narrowed it down with the panic attacks to the emergency services. You know, seeing that let's go, that quick reaction force, which is what I was a part of in Iraq. So, yeah, just a fire or AMBO or police, you know, it's like, let's go, you know, but I'm not a part of that. So I'm sitting at home. There's no need to let's go.
Kelli, you're in active recovery for an eating disorder. What's going on in your head on a bad day?
How I explain having an eating disorder is having a voice in your brain telling you how to keep this eating disorder alive. And that voice is incredibly strong. On a bad day, it's all you can hear. And it's telling you things. Don't eat, continue your eating disorder behaviours. And it's very, very difficult at times.
Is there anything that helps you deal with that voice?
When I was actively in an eating disorder, those trigger warnings would draw me in to content that was going to keep that voice going. Now I'm at a stage where those warnings help me decide whether or not I'm going to consume that content. So on a bad day where the voice is strong, I need to know that there is something in that social media post or podcast or YouTube video that could strengthen that voice, and I probably need to stay away from it.
Victoria, you're one of only a few people who study trigger warnings. What are they?
Trigger warnings are just an alert that something distressing might be upcoming. They're supposed to warn people that something that's in their, maybe in their present or in their past, either related to maybe a mental health concern or a past experience like trauma, that that might be something that's in the content you're about to consume. And then usually based on that, there's one of two actions you could take. You could choose to avoid the content completely, or there's the idea that getting the warning might help you to mentally prepare to cope with the content. So you see the warning and then you prepare yourself in some way and then consume the content, and presumably because you're prepared, then it will reduce how negative you feel about it.
When did we actually start using them?
The true iteration of trigger warnings we see now were first born on feminist message boards in the late 90s, at the very early age of the internet. And they were used primarily on posts surrounding trauma, sexual assault experiences, and also eating disorders. And they were used in a very specific way within a specific community. But then, of course, with the internet, it just boomed after the thousands. They spread all the way around the internet with the advent of social media. And then around the 2010s, they began making their way to college campuses in the US. And that's where we really saw them as like one of the mainstays of like US culture wars. And they just blew up in the media.
In general, are they used to flag specific types of experiences or situations?
They did have a very sort of clinical origin in the way that they were originally used. And the term trigger itself is from PTSD literature and from the way that clinicians and people talk about PTSD. But I think recently, and the way that we use them online, and they've sort of become a meme, we sort of use the word trigger very loosely. They're just used now generally to flag any range of negative experiences. So it's not restricted to, say, like a list of canonical traumas or a list of mental health concerns, but they're now just used on anything negative, and then also politically charged content as well.
Mm. Kelli, are there warnings that you find really helpful to see?
Yeah, absolutely. So it will say trigger warning, eating disorder behaviours, and it will often relate if someone has put in content regarding, for example, calorie counts or extreme exercise or restrictive diets. Those are the types of things that when you are in an eating disorder, you're looking for.
Rachael, you're a librarian. You run a website which is called the Trigger Warning Database. What is that?
It's a website created to document the different trigger and content warnings in books. So you can research and look up a specific book, and there should be a list of the content and trigger warnings within that book. Or you can use it to search for specific trigger warnings and see a list of all the books that contain.
So how many books and trigger warnings are we talking about here?
We have over 12,000 books in the database, and we have about 300 categories.
What are the most popular searches?
They tend to be around the kind of the most common sense ones. So like rape, child abuse, domestic violence, animal cruelty and death, and eating disorders.
Topics like asthma are also listed. Why are those included?
A lot of feedback from people who use our website have contributed to our list and let us know what they are looking for when it comes to content warnings.
Why did you want to start it?
Personal experience. I have a needle phobia, so I was reading a book that had a really graphic blood test scene in it, and it caused me a lot of distress. So I looked up, just use Google, trying to find something kind of like what I created, if it already existed, and there was nothing like it. So I started collecting warnings for the books I was reading and publishing them, and eventually it kind of grew into the website.
So if you type needle into your own database, a bunch of books will come up,
yeah,
and you will say to yourself, I'm not going to read those because they're going to upset me, or at least I know this is in the,
yeah,
book.
I find that pre-warning is the best help for me. But everyone's different, and yeah.
What kind of feedback have you had about the database?
Overwhelmingly positive, which has been really nice. Just lots of people who say that before they read a book, they check out our website and see if it's listed, so it can help them decide whether they're in the right frame of mind to be reading that or not.
Victoria, what does your research tell us about the impact that trigger warnings can have on us?
Generally, across all of the labs that have looked at it so far, trigger warnings don't seem to increase avoidance at all, and in some studies can actually draw, say, trauma survivors towards content that's related to their own trauma. So I think except when you think of a warning, sometimes it can make things even more attractive and you become curious about the content. It's called the forbidden fruit hypothesis. So that's the avoidance side of it. So in lab and everything that we've seen so far, they don't seem to be very good at promoting this avoidance message. If we turn to the other side of the argument, which is the state of view side, we also don't see any evidence at all across the board for any form of emotional preparation from trigger warnings. So you can show people in lab a trauma film and one set of people is warned beforehand and another set isn't, and they will respond exactly the same way.
In your view, are trigger warnings effective?
No, my sort of big take home would be that they don't really do much of anything. And I think that that can be quite sinister in and of itself, because a lot of people use them intending to do the right thing or use them as part of an official policy, particularly looking at social media platforms that use them as part of a mental health policy, but they're not actually doing much for anyone. And so you're leaving people that are potentially maybe in a vulnerable category without any help at all.
So if they're not effective, why do so many of us feel like they are helpful for us?
Fear of the unknown is the fear that underlies every single human fear. And so I think reducing any form of the unknown makes people feel good. But I think maybe just the illusion of control makes people feel good. So there's also like maybe they are just generally fostering a culture of care and people think, oh, this presenter actually cares about me, or this presenter might be approachable if I wanted to talk to my lecturer about something and I know they use trigger warnings, so I know that they're going to be on my side. So there's all those kind of things to also consider. But when we're just looking at the direct behaviours, when we see a trigger warning, that's where, yeah, there's not a lot of evidence for anything going on.
Can trigger warnings have a negative impact on people?
They can. In the lab studies we've seen, once people do see a warning, they do become anxious. Doesn't seem to carry through to how they then interpret the material, except in a few cases in the literature. So in one study, we did find that trauma survivors were seemed to be carrying through that anxiety through to the stuff they were watching, which is not great. Did also seem to change their appraisals about their own trauma. So seeing a trigger warning in this particular study made trauma survivors feel that their trauma was more central to their identity. And trauma centrality is a really, really, it's a predictor of maintenance of PTSD symptoms. So it's not a great thing to have. It's the belief that sort of your traumatic event is like a real turning point in your life and central to your life story. And yet it doesn't bode well for trauma survivors to centralize their identity around that.
Did your research show anything about, say, blurred images on screen or on a post, whether users actually read the trigger warning and then didn't click through?
Yeah, so do vulnerable, what's quote-unquote vulnerable users, people with the psychopathology, would they, when they see these types of screens, do they avoid the content underneath? The answer is no. People are overwhelmingly very curious about what's underneath the blurred screen. Most people, 85%, will click through to view that image. And the 15% of people that avoid the image aren't these people with these vulnerability characteristics. In one of our studies, we found it was the opposite direction. So people with like vulnerabilities like depression and PTSD were more likely to want to see what the image was. And so people tend to keep looking up at horrible images, even though they have this warning message. Their curiosity gets the better of them.
Kelli, have trigger warnings ever fueled that voice in your head that encourages disordered eating?
Oh, 100%. So when you can find content that reinforces that voice, it makes you feel like you're not alone. So before I started recovery, I would go straight towards that trigger warning because that's what I wanted to see. I wanted to have that voice reinforced. It was only when I began treatment that I guess the clinician said, social media needs to go. And I didn't want to let go of all my social media, so that's when trigger warnings became important of things that I maybe needed to avoid.
Tiffany, you're a content creator on TikTok. Trigger warnings are commonplace on social media. How do you feel about trigger warnings online?
I grew up in a, you know, environment like a lot of people have where, you know, you followed the notion that some things we just didn't talk about, and that was just ingrained into us. And as I got older, I realised how damaging that was, because things would come up and I'm like, I can't talk about that. That's a taboo subject. And then on my own terms, as I, you know, grew, I went, no, I'm going to change this. I want to be more about normalising conversations, even if it's about uncomfortable topics. That really became my passion, what I believed, because I believed if I talk about it, it might encourage someone else in this room who's had a similar experience to talk about it. That was always my thoughts. So when I started seeing all these trigger warnings, I feel like they were working completely against that because it was putting the notion straight away that, hey, we're having this conversation, but here's a massive trigger, a warning, putting this idea in your head that this is an uncomfortable topic. We need to approach it with caution. Basically just red flags. And I was like, oh, all right, I feel like this is sending us backwards and instead of sending us forwards. So I've warmed up to them, but I still have my reservations when it comes to them.
When you see a warning, say, in a caption, what sort of runs through your mind? Do you think about the motivation of why that warning is there?
A lot of the time, especially on TikTok, I think it's just there to cover bases. People just do it because they don't want to be cancelled. I don't think they actually sometimes care about it. It's almost like a list of just checking it off. Trigger warning for this, 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 this and this. But I just don't know if it's the most effective way because I don't think a lot of people are using it well as well.
Do you warn your followers about potentially upsetting content?
I've never used the term trigger warning in a serious sense. But because my content is usually quite lighthearted and fun, I am aware that the people who follow me and watch it and they see my face, they're expecting that. They're expecting me to make a silly video, making a little, you know, a little joke here and then. So when I did post a video that was a bit more on the heavy side and I was discussing my mental health and a struggle I was going through, I just started off the video as a conversation just saying, just a heads up, this isn't my normal type of content. So yes, I guess that's a warning, but I didn't ever word it as a trigger warning. I just did it because I thought it was the considerate and right thing to do. And if they're expecting a laugh and they just get hit with a, you know, emotional trauma dumping, some people aren't in the mood for that. And I didn't want to do that to someone without giving them a bit of a heads up.
Mm. Chris, before we contacted you to be on this show, what did you know about trigger warnings?
Yeah, nothing at all. I mean, I'd heard the two words before, but put together, no. I'm aware of the trigger warnings before an article, after the headline, and yeah, so very little and a little bit confused as to how the topic is a topic, although, yeah, after tonight, learning what it's all about.
Would warnings on topics like war, for example, be helpful for you on a day-to-day basis?
No, not at all. Yeah, I feel like I can pick up a military magazine and that will put me in a not a great state of mind, but to get over that threshold of the panic attack is just purely the emergency vehicles. So, yeah, it's quite niche. I don't think a trigger warning would do anything for me personally. So,
is there any content you avoid, not necessarily online, but movies or books or
yeah,
anything
heaps.
Like that?
Yeah, anything military, politics, news. Look, unless someone's smiling and it's fishing and diving or something, I'm just not interested, hey? It's too tough.
Rachael, your baby daughter Mackenzie died when she was 7 months old from a rare genetic condition. Do trigger warnings about topics like child loss help you?
No, they actually harm me. My life for the last 7 years has been what other people would find triggering or traumatic. 7 miscarriages, 2 terminations for medical reasons in second trimester, 9 rounds of IVF, countless surgeries, and also watching my daughter die. So I've done a lot of media, podcasts, interviews, and people put trigger warnings on my story and that really hurts me. My daughter doesn't deserve to be covered in trigger warnings.
So who do you think the warnings are intended for?
I've been contacted a few times on my Instagram asking for trigger warnings on my content and every single time they have been from someone who is pregnant. They are scared of what could eventuate, and whilst I understand that and I have empathy of the fear because I went through countless pregnancies wondering whether I got to keep them, but that's part of life, that's part of being a parent, that sometimes children have disabilities, sometimes children pass away, there are things that you have to face head on, and that's one of the responsibilities as a parent. But it really upset me that people are coming from such a privileged position and they've got a sense of no empathy or selfishness, that they come into my space where I talk about my daughter and they ask me to cover it up for fear that it might happen to them, so they're just adding pain on top of my pain. It really angers me.
Are there situations that you find triggering?
Absolutely. So I have PTSD and anxiety, so does my husband. We're both police officers as well. So there are situations with PTSD. I have had to take my sons back to the same hospital that she died in. Ambulances going past, the sound of them just take me back to us going to hospital for the last time. But for me, the things that trigger me and have done for a long time are pregnancy announcements. They're gender reveals when it's a little girl. It's people doing the new free birthing, or when people say no to medical interventions for their children. They're the things that trigger me. But I'm not going to ask someone to put a trigger warning on a pregnancy announcement. That's for me to know what my triggers are, and that's for me to work on them.
Can you see any scenario where you think trigger warnings could be beneficial?
I can't speak for other topics. Like, I'm very much in the space of miscarriage, IVF, infertility, child loss. In those areas, reading articles make me feel like I'm not alone, and it actually also makes me feel really proud of whichever media outlets publishing it, that they're not turning away from the hard topics. But I can't talk to other forms of trauma.
We have issued trigger warnings. Sometimes we prefer to call them content notes or disclaimers.
We do use trigger warnings, and for us it's important because we are a social first news platform.
You just slap on the warning, you're done. You don't have to fix anything about the content you're presenting.
Coco's driving a pink Lamborghini Aventador, which costs about $500.
My cats are pets, so I don't call them fur babies. I don't push them around in prams or dress them up.
Would you choose your pet over your partner?
I choose the pet.
I think there's a great deal of social pressure. It's very difficult to come out and be like, I can't take care of my pet, I need to rehome it.
Pet ownership is not what it once was.
The warning that our coverage contains distressing content.
This is graphic and this is jarring.
What is going on?
I'm not getting any answer on problem.
Before we start this story, we want to let you know that it contains violent and distressing content, including references to sexual violence and racist slurs.
I should give you a bit of a warning because the story does contain vision of whales that are in distress.
Let's put a trigger warning on trigger warnings. They don't work. It's like if seatbelts were made out of broken glass.
The people from New South Wales are triggered so easily by the word potato cake.
Just a trigger warning, okay, guys? It's a trigger warning.
Trigger warning.
Trigger warning.
I want to talk about the word trigger.
Victoria, if research suggests that trigger warnings don't work, why do you think we're seeing so many of them?
I think that they've just become embedded in the current sort of culture war discourse and online discourse, and it's become just the norm now and the cultural norm. And I think we can be seen that if we don't use them or put them on everything, then you may be personally cancelled or a organisation may be in trouble, or I think it's just seen as the right thing to do. And it's also an incredibly easy thing to do. You just slap on the warning, you're done. You don't have to fix anything about the content you're presenting. You don't have to change anything about your messaging. You just put a warning on it and then, oh, I've warned you, so now that's in your hands to cope with whatever I'm going to say.
You're also a psychology lecturer. Yep. Do you use trigger warnings before you present content to your students?
I tend to use what I would call an anti-trigger warning, where I will tell them that the content of the lecture is going to be this, but I also want you to know that some of my research, or all of my research, shows that this warning isn't going to do anything for you.
Billy, you're the editor of The Daily Oz. This is a news platform for young Australians. Does your publication use trigger warnings?
So we do use trigger warnings, and for us it's important because we are a social first news platform, and that means that a lot of our content is on social media like Instagram before it's on our website. And Instagram is a place that obviously a lot of people go to see photos of their friends and families, and they're not necessarily expecting to see triggering content because Instagram isn't the traditional place that news is on. And so for us, it's all about a choice and people having a choice about whether they want to consume triggering content. So that's why we do use them.
What kind of topics do you provide trigger warnings for?
So a whole range of topics, and it's important to say that it's been informed by the audience. So every time we use a trigger warning, it's because a number of people from our audience have told us that they would like a trigger warning on topics like that. So things like suicide, sexual abuse, domestic violence, topics like that, our audience has told us is important that they have a choice before they decide to consume that content.
Is there anything you wouldn't give a trigger warning to, even if your audience asked you for it?
That's a really interesting question. I don't think that that issue has come up, but if it was a topic that we hadn't previously put a trigger warning on a news story of that topic, we would look into it to see if that's something that is wanted by a lot of people.
Dilpreet, you're the online editor for South Asian Today. Do you use trigger warnings?
We have issued trigger warnings. Sometimes we prefer to call them content notes or disclaimers or viewer discretion is advised or precautionary notice. I find those words much more engaging than the word trigger warning. But if a piece is going into distressing details or difficult details about sexual violence or racial violence or any kind of abuse, we would offer viewer or reader discretion. But if it is a headline or a to-the-point brief notice, then we would take an editorial stand and check if we really need to issue a trigger warning. For example, when Indian students were stuck in Ukraine, we were in direct contact with them. And at that point, our main concern was to break ground news and to raise awareness. So if the news is that an Indian student has died in Ukraine during shelling, then that's the headline. I'm going to take the editorial stand of not issuing a content warning because we're not going into details of that. It's just breaking news.
Why do you think publishers use them?
I do think that when we started, there was a personal relationship between the readers and independent publisher. As an independent publisher, I do understand that we're not working in a large newsroom. We don't have a lot of resources at our disposal. And the chain of content production is rather short. So there's a very personal relationship between you and the reader. So I do think that publishers thought of readers and kept their readers in mind. But as we progressed, it became sort of a checklist. And I think they started offering them because they think they had to. And what that did was it reduced the quality of intention behind offering that trigger warning. And I think that kind of became tokenistic along the way.
How do you feel about your readers asking for a trigger warning to be used?
Some I've taken on and some I haven't.
Have some of those requests been, say, unreasonable in your view?
Yes. Once I edited a piece which was a historical piece of British colonization in India, and it was a timeline piece, so it traced key occurrences that happened in the subcontinent. It did not have any details of any violence of the British Raj in India. It was very much just a factual piece. So when we published it, we got requests of, oh, you should put trigger warning colonization on this piece. And I remember taking an editorial stand of, no, because it actually has no distressing details. It's very much a historical data piece. And it came from a demographic which I didn't even think had honestly been to India. I grew up there and colonization is very much a personal story for us. So just saying colonization or just saying British colonization of India is very much our history. It's not triggering. So I think I would make the choice of whether that piece demanded it, and this particular piece didn't, and I so did not take it on. Mm.
Tiffany, how do you and your friends use the word triggered?
It's such a dramatic word for right reasons when it's used in the right way. But because it's so dramatic, I've made content about triggers for parents, you know, just because to poke fun at them.
This is the TikToks that you do called Triggering Australian Parents. How are you using the term in that context?
Exactly how it said. I realised, I don't know what it was, I think we're talking about putting the dryer on, and I remembered that my mum, every time I put the dryer on, she acted like the world was ending. So I made an entire series of all these things I remember that I did when I was a kid, and did it to like trigger her, just to like for a bit of fun. And I showed her the video and she's like, Tiffany, please don't. And I realised that a lot of people commented and said, oh, I've had that same experience. Like, you know, haha, how funny are our parents? You know, we put the car light on and they act like we're going to, you know, be pulled over by the police. So yes, I've used the word, obviously in a silly way, because it's such a dramatic word, pairing it with something so insignificant as a dryer being turned on or a cheesecake. The contrast I find funny. But I have learnt, you know, just with time. I mean, I made that video a few years ago. I've never had anyone come at me for, you've used the word trigger wrong. I think everyone knew it was just a bit of, you know, joking around. But yes, I've definitely been guilty of being one of those people who've just said it for the sake of a cheap laugh.
Chris, you're managing PTSD, which stems from childhood trauma. You're also an actor.
Mm-hmm.
Are trigger warnings used much in theatre?
They are. I've done over 50 theatre shows, never used one, and I'm happy about that because I find we've had content warnings, may contain strobe lights, may nudity, etc. And I think I don't really have it. Like, seeing it written on the screen there contains themes of, that doesn't do anything to me. I read the word trigger warning, it sets up an expectation. Now, a big part of abuse is walking on eggshells and the expectation that the abuse is coming.
What about when you hear the word triggered being used outside of a trauma context?
That's a good question, because some people can use it as a way to talk about their feelings and have a really a conversation about how they're feeling and how they're overcoming it. Others can use it as a joke, but then again, I worry about the exploitative people that are using it, or the vulnerable dark personalities that are using it to get that attention, to get that clickbait, to get the clicks and to get the views.
Mm.
Because it's kind of like you're ripping me off.
Rachael, what goes through your head when triggered is used in a more casual way?
I really struggle with the terminology that society is using these days. I hear people say trauma when they mean uncomfortable, sad, disappointed, upset. There's so many words that we can use, yet people are using these really heavy and dramatic words. And then when there's people like me who need to use them to be able to show how hard the last 6 years have been, I have no other language left to use that people will pay attention to, because they're desensitized by it.
According to your South Sudanese, is there a word for trauma in your culture?
We don't have any word in my language that, like, trauma. We don't have that, or maybe I just don't speak good Dinka, but from as far as I know, no, we don't have that word.
In 2015, your mum drove her car into a lake outside Melbourne with four of her children. These were your siblings, inside. How did your life change after that incident?
You know, I was just a young girl, fresh out of high school, and, you know, here to tackle, like, my life, trying to go to uni, live on campus, get a job, you know, get my license. I only had like 5 hours of like driving lessons. So it was kind of hard for me, because I kind of had to automatically turn into a mum overnight for my little sisters, because I just didn't want them to like go into care.
You were 18 at the time?
Yeah.
So you told Child Protection basically that you'll look after them, you'll get a job.
Yeah.
Did the media coverage of your mum's story at the time include any trigger warnings?
No, they did not at all. I remember during my mum's trial, they played, like, an audio the ambulance must have picked it up when they were coming to rescue my siblings. And in court, they played that, and it was basically like kids screaming, my mom screaming, you know, just crying for help and stuff. And you can hear, like, you know, that sound of someone struggling and, like, trying to survive. And there was no trigger warning at all that time, I remember.
Do you think there should have been warnings?
I think there should, because just for... I felt like it was a bit insensitive of them, because it's hard for my mom, like, these are her children. And for her to hear that, you know, automatically takes her back to that time and place that it happened. Mm. And I felt like they were a bit insensitive to her feelings at the time.
Do you think trigger warnings are a helpful way to be sensitive to people's mental health concerns?
I think yes, and it's a good and a bad thing, but then it kind of makes you anxious. Like, if I see a woman that just passed with her child in a house fire or something, and then, like, there's a photo of their house burn or something, the kid's toy or something, like, obviously, if the description's there, I'm not gonna... I'll read about it, but then it will make me anxious to click that, what was blurred, because I don't know what I'm gonna see. Mm. Yeah.
Georgina, you're a mother. You appreciate trigger warnings before distressing news stories about children. Mm. Why is that?
I consume a lot of traditional media, mostly, a lot of radio. I've often got news radio on in the kitchen, in my car, and it allows me the opportunity from those really graphic descriptions to be able to choose whether that is going to be appropriate content for my children, who are likely going to be in the same room, and flick away. And then the other thing is, sometimes I need a little bit of space from particularly emotive content as well.
Mm. What kind of stories have affected you deeply?
I'm listening to news radio and I'm making breakfast, and I'm dealing with, you know, one minor crisis of, you know, the homework that hasn't been done and the library book that can't be found and breakfast needs to be made and lunches and that sort of thing. And for me to then have an emotional response, it means that I sort of can't be that present parent, that calm parent, being able to solve my children's problems and help talk them through it, because I'm having my own kind of deeply emotional response to that information.
Mm. You're an ICU nurse. You must deal with incredibly stressful situations every day. Why do you think it is stories about children that distresses you so much? Is that because of personal experience?
I think since becoming a parent, I think I wear my heart on my sleeve a lot more. I don't work with children professionally, but I have certainly seen children say goodbye to parents, parents say goodbye to their children. So for me, I'm no stranger to grief. The grief is more real. The trauma that they've gone through is not something abstract. They are humans. I see their humanity, and I can't distance myself from that to kind of go, oh, well, and back to making the toast.
Rachael, do you think that trigger warnings show that we're more conscious of what other people might be feeling, that sort of compassion?
No. I really question who they're for and where we're going with it. I remember after Mackenzie passed away and I was watching the news and crying because, yeah, becoming a parent makes you more empathetic and more emotional, and then losing a child, I would cry watching the news, and my husband Johnny would say, I think it's time that we turned the news off. And I said no, because I thought, what if someone turned off Mackenzie? I feel like I need to witness other people's life. Isn't it the least that I can do when they have to live in the trauma for their life?
Rachael, your trigger warning database flags themes like cheating and the death of a grandparent in novels. How much are topics like these trauma-related, and how much is it about bracing people for being upset?
I think it's a bit of both. I think it started out definitely trauma-related, and I think the line between trigger and content can be quite blurred. I don't know people's experiences. I don't know what's going to upset them or cause a trauma response for them. It's so individual, but I think I can cover as many topics as possible. And I think the interesting things tonight being discussed, being articles, being TikToks, which are quick and something you kind of, you don't stumble across a news article. You probably are on social media looking for it or something like that, where a book is something you pick up with a bit more intention and you sit with it for 500 pages. So I think preparing people who have mental health conditions for what they're going to be diving into deeply is worth it, whether it's a trigger or content warning. Mm.
Tiffany, you regularly visit a similar website which is called Does the Dog Die? What is it?
This website's been around for a very long time. And it's something that, you know, every time I was watching a movie, even when I was a kid, you know, I've had experiences like a lot of people with pets have, that, you know, I never had siblings and I had really close relationships with my dogs. And when I lost them when I was younger, that was the most traumatic thing for me as a kid. And I've never really gotten better at it. I found this website and I'm like, perfect. So you put the movie in, it tells you, and it comes up there, does it, yes or no? If it says yes, it tells you what time, you can choose to miss it, blah, blah, blah.
Could you imagine if someone looked away from Mackenzie and then they ended up having a child severely impacted by a genetic condition that could have had an early treatment or something that they could have learnt from our story, but they didn't because it made them uncomfortable?
It's been 10 years since the accident. When my mom left, I became my sister's guardian. These were my little siblings. And then this is me. I'm the oldest. Felt like I had to just step in, and I don't want my siblings to go into the system. But it was just kids raising kids, basically. When I look at this, I see how mothers feel now. Yeah. I have two twin boys, they're 4 years old. It's hectic, just boys running around constantly and causing chaos. At times it's stressful, but at times it's really cute. I wanna be able to like give my little sister and like the boys whatever my mom couldn't back then, you know? I wanna set an example too for my siblings. I think it's important to have your mom around. No one can give you that love and comfort. Your mom will never judge you. She'll always protect you and your feelings. I didn't get to have that touch with my mom. Being Sudanese, we don't really talk about therapy or like things that are like bothering us. I don't want my kids to ever be like that. I want them to always tell me anything that's bothering them. And for them to know, like, it's okay to be upset. It's okay to have a bad day at school. I don't want to be defined by what happened to my family. Like, it is sad, but that's not who I am. I'm strong.
Akoi, are there things that you're able to do now that were difficult for you before?
Yeah, now I'm back on social media. I do a bit of like modeling on the side, and it's, I think taking some time off has helped me. It kind of regained my confidence again, and you know, it's been like 10 years now that since the accident, so I feel like I'm able to just be myself again without, you know, seeing bad stuff about my family.
You work in aged care.
Mm.
Has being able to handle things differently helped you in that job?
It kind of has. I get to meet like lovely older people every day, and they tell me their stories and about their life. So it's helped me a lot.
Has anyone ever sort of spoken to you about your mum's case?
Yeah, I had a client one day, and my mum's topic just came up, and she was just going hard at my mum, just saying like, oh, her bad stuff happened to this woman. The poor kids, you know, I wonder where they are now. I heard they got taken by child protection. And I just, you know, I was calm in that moment, and I was at peace, because it showed how much strength and how much I've actually worked on myself. And I didn't even react. I was even talking to her about it. It just took me back to where, when it first happened, when people were saying horrible stuff, and I was like, you know, she was one of those people that was saying horrible stuff back then that I couldn't really defend my mum about. Mm. So I'm just gonna let her be with the others back then.
You have a tattoo on your wrist.
Yeah.
What does it say?
My tattoo says resilient. I got it when I was like 22, just me and my friend. I was thinking of what to get for so long, and then I put that on my wrist because it just speaks to me about how far I've come and how resilient I've become and how strong, that I was able to handle so much on my plate that now, like, I'm doing my own stuff, I'm studying now, I'm gonna be a nurse. And, you know, my siblings are good and my kids are good and, yeah.
Chris, how important is resilience to managing your trauma?
It's probably the most important part of it. Having chronic unworthiness and then codependence, people-pleasing, to get to the point where it was just whittling down the choices to become... It was either self-delete or continue. And once I got to that point, the only way was up, right? So I researched everything I could, and that's balancing the feelings with the data, realising I'm not alone. We're all not alone.
Rachael, do you think there are consequences to using trigger warnings regularly?
There is... resilience. There's beauty, there's post-traumatic growth that I've experienced. I'm a far better person now after Mackenzie than I ever was before. Life used to be black and white, and now it's got depth, it's colour. And so there's beauty, and we need to have some resilience. And then there's a societal issue of, if we keep curating our lives and looking away, is society going to keep developing solutions for problems that we have?
Kelli, what are your thoughts? Do you think that trigger warnings can sort of take away from that ability to be resilient, or can they play a role in actually building resilience?
I think they can play a role in building resilience. I think there are probably times in people's lives where they just aren't resilient enough to deal with certain content. But it gives people the choice about whether or not they're going to view the content when they're ready. And it is, it's that exposure therapy. It's viewing that content when you are feeling safe and ready and you've got the tools to deal with anything that comes up. That can help build your resilience.
Chris, you've never relied on trigger warnings and hadn't heard of them much until this show. What's it been like listening to this discussion?
Yeah, it's been really educational. It seems to be one of those topics that there's just not a yes or no, not a black and white. You know, for me personally, they have no effect on me, and I can't see how they ever would. Whereas someone else, they have a lot of effect, and it's a really good thing. And we can't take that away from you. And yeah, I don't think it's black and white.
Rachael, 6 years ago, your daughter Mackenzie died before her first birthday. You still like to post about her on social media alongside pictures of your two sons, Zach and Josh. Why do you do that?
It started because I just wanted to say her name. I wanted the world to know she was here. For people who have lost babies, especially, they're here for such a short amount of time, and we're terrified that the world's not going to know. I remember leaving the hospital after she died and the world was just normal. Everyone was just walking around. They couldn't tell that the most beautiful little girl had just gone and that my life had been shattered. And so I just wanted to say her name. And then we were campaigning for change around genetic carrier screening and wanting to bring it to Australia and wanting to make it available for free for everyone. And so I began using my Instagram and my voice to be able to campaign for that, to speak to government, to teach people about when you have genetic carrier screening, what it can do, whether you want it because it's a choice. And I find it difficult that if people are turning away from stories like mine because they feel uncomfortable, they're missing the message. And could you imagine if someone looked away from Mackenzie and then they ended up having a child severely impacted by a genetic condition that could have had an early treatment or something that they could have learnt from our story, but they didn't because it made them uncomfortable?
We often use trigger warnings to avoid distressing content. For you, have there been some positives to not turning away?
Absolutely. It's so hard to describe, but it's part of the post-traumatic growth. Like, I was very angry and have gone in and out of a bad place for a long time now, but I've got a community online of people who have lost children, but so many people who are just parents who haven't, and they want to learn from me. They like hearing about the good and the bad. It makes them feel like they can parent better. There's a lot of positives about not turning away and seeing some of the depth and the colour in life. Trauma is horrific and impacts my every single day, but there's positives, there's beauty, it's life, it's feelings.
Thank you so much, and thank you so much to you all for being here. That's all we have time for. I'd like to thank you for joining us as well. If you'd like to catch up on this episode or any others, you can go to SBS On Demand. And if you'd like to sit in this studio and be part of our audience, please follow the link on your screen. I'll see you next time.